I'm really excited to welcome Roshni Joshi today from Google, who will be talking to us. Roshni, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Absolutely, and thank you so much for having me. I'm super excited to be here and talk to all the folks at SciGirls. So as Roxanne mentioned, my name is Roshni. I am part of Google Cloud and I'm based out here in Chicago. So joining you live from my spare bedroom at home. I have been at Google for a little bit over a year, and for the last 22 years, I've had a career in technology. I have been mostly in on the vendor side, as in I work with different people in the industry, are my customers, and find out what they are looking to do, what they're looking to build, what business challenges they're trying to solve, and we help build them for those. Most recently, in my current role, I'm part of Google Cloud's customer engineering team, where we work with our enterprise customers to understand what they're trying to accomplish and help build those things on our Google platform, Google Cloud platform.
So how would you describe what you do to the general public?
Absolutely. So in order to describe what I do to the general public, I usually start with a little bit of background and history on Google. So for the last 21 years, Google has been most popularly defined by our search engine, right? But really, there are many, many different business units across Google, and all of us are anchored around a mission statement, which is to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. And if you look at our plethora of products, each one of our products aims to do just that. And Google wants to become not only the place where you come to find answers, but the place where you come to get help to get things done in your life. So whether you look at Google YouTube, Google Maps, Google Search, our Gmail, you're going to all of these applications to get things done. And each one of these applications that I just mentioned has over a billion monthly users. So more than a billion people across the globe are using these applications in any given month. So Google Cloud, which is where I work, is the enterprise-focused division of Google, which means we work with bigger companies and help them accomplish the same kind of thing. So take the same hyperscale technologies that we've built at Google that support billions of users and apply it to their businesses to solve the same kind of problems that we've solved over the last 21 years or so. So that's my job. Super exciting. I get to talk to different customers every day. I get to find out what they're trying to do, what problems they're trying to solve, and then I try to map those problems back to technology solutions that are available on Google Cloud. So that's what I do.
That's awesome. What got you interested in this career?
So I wish I could say that it was a super planful career move. I'll give you a little bit of background of where I came from. So I grew up in India, and I came to the United States to get my master's. I got my bachelor's in engineering from India, and my focus was electrical engineering. And along the way, I realized as I was studying for my electrical engineering degree, and actually when I was pursuing my master's, my first interest was to get a further education in semiconductors or maybe biomedicine. That was one of my other interest areas. One of the things that I realized, though, is I really love human collaboration, human interaction, working with people. And a degree in electrical engineering, while it satisfied the curiosity in me and the researcher in me, didn't really satisfy the part of me that wanted to the human interaction and the human collaboration. So my next area of interest was computer science, based on the fact that I really like it when problems come together and we have a logical conclusion. And computer science was able to cater to that part of me. So I chose to get a master's in computer science. And initially, I started my career as an application developer. And then I focused on building technology infrastructure solutions, doing a lot of the practitioner work, which means I was actually building things. And then as I worked in different roles, I realized that what I loved about my job, the part that I loved, was talking to the people at the end customer to find out what they wanted, and meeting different people and learning what they wanted and building for those. And that's essentially what I do today. So it took me a good 15 years in my career before I got to where I wanted to get to, but now I'm here and I love it. So I wish I could say it was planfully organized, but one thing sort of led to another. And you know, I didn't sort of start off my career thinking I'm going to be a customer engineering director one day, but I sort of arrived there through a number of different career paths that I chose based on what I like to do.
What advice would you have for middle school and high school girls?
So I have a 16-year-old, so I have a high schooler and I have a 13-year-old son. So I have one of both. And I was asking them, hey, what would you like to hear from a 45-year-old? And they were like, Mom, we don't want to hear anything from you. So I'm not, my kids didn't help me much. My daughter suggested, well, maybe you could share with them like what you took in high school, but that wouldn't really translate very well. So I guess the advice I would share from a career perspective is you know, and it might sound a little generic, but truly, I didn't know what I wanted to do when I was 16 or when I was 17 or even when I was 20, right? I switched my career from electrical engineering, you know, hardcore, working on semiconductors, working on printed circuit boards, to something that was totally different. Not totally, it's still STEM, but very different from what I was doing. So it's okay to focus on what you think you're interested in, but it's also okay to switch your interests based on how you see your interests evolving, and also keeping track on how you see the market around you evolve. And I didn't quite realize the second part of it, like the market evolution. And you know, I didn't know when I was making my career decision that, you know, computer science would be such a big thing, especially after the year 2000. But if I was to look back at my younger self, I would have maybe paid closer attention to where is the market going, right? So that would be one big thing I would ask you to maybe not worry about. Don't worry so much about, I need to know exactly where I want to go when I'm 16. It's okay, you won't know. You will start down a number of different things, and even when you start your career in one place, you will end up at a different place. So my advice to you would be, like I said, don't worry too much about where you want to go. Focus on what you're doing right now, and whatever it is that you do, do it with passion, do it with interest, give it your best. And if it's not the thing that interests you, go find out what interests you. Don't spend your time, don't waste your time, you know, give it your all, but if it doesn't work for you, don't waste your time like working on something that isn't meaningful to you.
So the last question I have for you is, recently we've seen social movements like Me Too, and even more recently Black Lives Matter. Is there any advice that you have or any ideas that you have of how scientists and leaders in STEM could address the lack of diversity in STEM fields?
So I'll address my ideas around lack of diversity, and it's something that I'm super passionate about. And you know, all of us are going through the events over the last few days, few weeks, in you know, dramatically different ways. You know, some days it doesn't feel like business as usual. It doesn't feel like, you know, everything is normal from a day-to-day perspective as we are going around our work lives. Having said that, the first thing I want to acknowledge is everything, every aspect of our lives today are touched by technology. So the need for diversity in STEM is even stronger than it was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, certainly 15 years ago, right? Whether you're looking at gender diversity, geodiversity, generational diversity, these are super important perspectives to include in every facet of our digital world, because everything, like every industry, is going through this transformation, and the products of our future need to incorporate all colors, all genders, all all types of sexual orientation, religious orientation, all of that, right? We have to include that in our tapestry. So the thing that we are trying to do, I can talk to what we are trying to do to incorporate more diversity at Google is, first of all, we are super focused on how we hire. And even taking a step back, we are very, very intentional about measuring our impact of diversity, right? Every year, Google publishes our diversity report, and we've been one of the first companies to do that. We've been doing that for a number of years because we want to rank ourselves. We want to see, are we an A? Were we an A last year? And did we drop to a B? Or are we a C now, right? We want to see across like various different intersections how we are doing in diversity. The second thing we are doing is, you know, looking at the diversity we are bringing in, and you know that's a part of the measurement that we do ultimately, but looking at who we are bringing in and being very intentional about our hiring. The third thing that we are super focused on from a product perspective is making sure that as we are building our products, I'm using, you know, Google Chrome right now, we are using Meet right now for this meeting. Each one of these products have been, built with, you know, diverse skin tones in mind. So for example, the camera of the phone, the device I'm using right now, it was built in mind with the different skin tones of the different people who will be using the phone so that it adjusts the light. So think about even little things like that need to be looked through a diversity lens. So we are actually fostering not only our own employee resource groups and asking them to provide input into all our products, whether they are your Nest devices, your Pixel phones, or your Chromebooks, but we are also seeking out an external community of users to have direct input into our product. And thirdly, we are constantly like measuring ourselves against the products that we produce to make sure that that they meet our diversity guidelines. Specifically, artificial intelligence and machine learning is something that you'll hear a lot about in the industry. It's what everybody's trying to do. And we have a whole ethics committee around artificial intelligence, specifically because it impacts so many things. So we want to make sure that, you know, diversity is something that we are building into our artificial intelligence models so that it doesn't favor one ethnicity more than the other. It doesn't favor one racial group more than the other. It doesn't sort of perpetrate any kind of biasing, whether it's gender or racial, into the products, or not just the products that we are building, but the products that, for example, at Google Cloud that we offer to the customers that they are using and building on top of, and that doesn't get further propagated. So we're super intentional about that as well. Hopefully that answers your question.
That definitely does. Thank you so much, Roshni. Is there anything you want to add or any closing statements you want to make?
Just that, love the fact that this program is happening, that you're doing this. To all my friends who are watching this, please, we need you in STEM. We absolutely need the gender representation in STEM. Today, if I look across the board, specifically the number of women in the industry that I'm in the segments that I'm in, it's less than 20%. We want to raise that number. So please continue in your efforts to study, to learn, and to adopt a career in STEM.
Thank you so much.